part D, once again, we have a difference of argument. So we want to get everything in terms of just x here. And cosine, we have three choices for the cosine of 2 theta. We have the 2 cosine squared theta minus 1. We have 1 minus 2 sine squared theta. And we have cosine squared theta minus sine squared theta. So the question is, which of these is going to be most useful for us? Well, I see that I already have the right-hand side in terms of cosines. So that means I'm going to choose the first identity there. So I'm going to replace cosine 2x with 2 cosine squared x minus 1. And once again, in any time in algebra, you do a replacement or a substitution, you want to go ahead and put that in parentheses so we don't forget that we have to distribute this 4 to both terms. So we get 8 cosine squared x minus 4 is 2 cosine x minus 1. The highest power of cosine is cosine squared. That means I've got a quadratic equation here. And how do we solve quadratics? We get everything on one side, 0 on the other. So I'm going to keep the 8 cosine squared x on this side, subtract over the 2 cosine x. And when I add the 1 over, that's going to give me a minus 3. This gives me this equals 0. And if you need to, go ahead and look at the quadratic we're getting here. I've got 8 times something squared minus 2 times something minus 3 is 0. So if I'm just let u be cosine x, then this turns into this, and you might have a little more success here factoring that. So we need to get factors of 8 and combine them with factors of 3 to get this to work out. So we can try a 2 and a 4, see if we can get that to work out. So if I'm using a 2 and a 4, I need 3 here, factors of 3 that have a difference of 2. So I can try the minus 3 plus 1. So that gives me the minus 6u plus 4u. So that's exactly what we want. So that means over here, I can factor this as 2 cosine x plus 1 times 4 cosine x minus 3 equal to 0. And now I have the product of two real numbers that give me 0. That means that I've got either this is 0 or this is 0. From here, I get cosine x is minus 1 half. From here I get cosine x is 3/4. All right, cosine x equals negative 1/2. I know those angles. That's a common angle. Cosine is negative over there in quadrant 2 and quadrant 3. So reference angles pi over 3. So I get 2 pi over 3 plus 2 pi k or 4 pi over 3 plus 2 pi k. Where's cosine equal to positive 3/4? Well, 3/4 isn't one of the common angles that we know, so I got to use the arccosine function. So in quadrant 1, I get arccosine 3/4 plus 2 pi k. And the other place the cosine is positive is over there in quadrant 4. And so in quadrant 1, I've got this guy. In quadrant 4, I can use that as the reference angle, so it's 2 pi minus that, plus 2 pi k, where once again, k is our friendly integer, and so on. All right, so that's the family of solutions. Now we have to decide which ones of those lie between 0 and 2 pi. And so what I'm going to do is just get rid of the algebra scratch work here, and we'll just tuck the answer in up here. So in 0 to 2 pi, what am I going to get here? Well, from this family, I'm just going to get the 2 pi over 3. Here I'm going to get the 4 pi over 3. Here, the arc cosine of 3 quarters is an acute angle. Okay, so that is going to be between 0 and 2 pi. If I add or subtract 2 pi, I'm either going to get an angle that's bigger than 2 pi or an angle that's negative, so I'm done there. 2 pi minus the arc cosine is between 0 and 2 pi, because the arc cosine of 3 quarters, once again, is an acute angle. But if I add or subtract multiples of 2 pi here, I'm either going to get something bigger than 2 pi or smaller than 0. And so those are my four answers, and that'll do it to part D. Okay, our last equation, part E. Once again, we notice we have the same argument, so that's good. But we do have two different trigonometric functions involved. So we're going to use an identity to relate the two. So since I have a tangent squared, I think of the identity. Tangent squared is secant squared minus 1. What that'll do is exchange tangent squareds for secant squareds, and then I'll give me an equation in terms of just secants. So that's what we'll do. And then I have a quadratic equation in terms of secant. So I'm going to get everything on one side, 0 on the other. So I get secant squared x. I'm going to subtract over the secant of x. And when I subtract over the plus 1, I get a minus 2. And so sometimes it helps to think of what quadratic equation we have here. If I think of u as being the secant of x, then I've got u squared minus u minus 2 is 0, which I can readily factor as u minus 2 times u plus 1. So that means that I can factor this equation as secant of x minus 2 times secant of x plus 1. And now I've got the product of two real numbers, which gives me 0. That means we set each of these guys equal to 0. Like so. From here I get the secant of x is 2. From here I get the secant of x is negative 1. And I'm much better at cosines than secants. So if secant of x is 2, that means the cosine of x is the reciprocal, 1 half. Or the cosines are reciprocal. The reciprocal of negative 1 is also negative 1. So where's cosine equal to 1 half? Well, that's at pi over 3 in quadrant 1. Or any coterminal angle there. Or it could be in quadrant 4 at 5 pi over 3 plus any coterminal angle there. Where's cosine equal to negative 1? Well, that's just at pi. Where once again, we let k run through the integers to capture all the coterminal angles. In 0 to 2 pi, what do we have? Well, from the first family, we just get pi over 3. From the second family, we just get 5 pi over 3. And from the last family, we just get pi. So this is plugging in the k's like we've done the last few examples. That'll do it for part E, and that'll do it for number 1.